डिजिटल इंडिया, एजुकेटेड इंडिया।
गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम टू द फ्लूइड मैकेनिक्स कोर्स। वी आर डिस्कसिंग सॉल्यूशंस ऑफ नेवियर-स्टोक्स इक्वेशंस, एंड इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड द बेसिक गवर्निंग इक्वेशन, हाउ वी डिराइव्ड, एंड we also discussed the crowd flow and its derivation and various applications. All right, now in today's class we will discuss the next two categories of exact solutions. One is plain Poiseuille flow, next one is Hagen-Poiseuille flow. All right, with plain Poiseuille flow, what do we consider? We consider again two plates, flow between two parallel plates, and in this case we consider a steady flow between two parallel plates as shown in this figure. And as you can see, because both the plates are fixed, you consider the center at the middle of these two plates. So if we consider this as the origin, then this is our x direction, this is our y direction. Okay. Now the flow is going to be independent of any variation in the z direction. What is z direction? That is the direction perpendicular to this screen. Okay. Now the variation, because the plates are infinitely broad and the flow is taking place in the x direction, the variation in the z direction is going to be zero. So you can write down the governing equation like this. We have already derived earlier how we neglected various different velocities and different terms depending on the velocities, and finally the simplified equation can be written like this. You had the dou u by dou t term, but because this is a steady flow, you don't have to consider that. Okay, so once we have a steady flow, the dou u by dou t term disappears, and similarly when we say that flow is independent of z direction, then the variation of u in z direction is going to be zero. So dou u by dou z is also equal to zero. Now the dou square u by dou z square term is also neglected. So finally what you have is dou p by dou x plus mu dou square u by dou y square. All right, now what are the boundary conditions? If you look at this flow, we have two boundaries. One is upper plate boundary, one is lower plate boundary. And if I say y, y is plus 1 by 2 or plus h by 2 minus h by 2. So at y equals to plus h by 2 and minus h by 2, my velocities are going to be 0. So I can write down that the boundary conditions at y equals to h by 2, u is equals to 0, and y is equals to minus h by 2, u is also equals to 0. Now once we have this boundary conditions and the governing equation for this particular case, let us find out the value of the velocity. So how do you get it? You integrate the mu d square dou square u by dou y square, you integrate twice and you will get the value of u. So if we do that, you can see this is the equation, and if we rewrite and integrate, first you will get dou u by dou y is equals to 1 by mu dou p by dou x y plus c1, and second integration will give you u is equals to 1 by 2 mu dou p by dou x y square plus c1 y plus c2. All right, so here we have these two constants which have come up, c1 as well as c2. Now we need to find out these constants by applying our boundary conditions. So if you apply the boundary conditions, first of all your c1 will become 0, right, and your c2 is going to be minus 1 by mu dou p by dou x h square by 8. All right. So let us substitute these two values in the equation u and see what is the solution. So once we substitute, we can write down u is equals to 1 by 2 mu dou p by dou x y square minus 1 by mu dou p by dou x h square by 8. So if you take this minus h square by 8 minus h square by 8 mu dou p by dou x outside, you can write down 1 minus 4 y by h whole square, right? So this is just rephrasing this equation, nothing else. Once we have this equation, what do we understand from this? You can clearly see that u is equals to this term, which is a parabolic equation. So that itself indicates that the velocity profile within the two plates is going to be parabolic. Okay, so which implies that the velocity profile is going to be parabolic within the plates. All right. Now, once we have understood this, next let us find out all other parameters. Let us try to obtain the maximum velocity. Without even looking further, one can always tell that the maximum velocity is going to occur at the center line, that is y is equals to 0. Okay, or in normalized term, when we are representing it as y by h, any distance as y by h, we can tell that at y by h is equal to 0, the velocity is going to be maximum. So that's what we could write, y by h is equal to 0, u is going to be u max, because the flow is symmetric and all the conditions are symmetric. Now, if we substitute that in the equation, this is our equation. In this equation, if you substitute y by h is equals to 0, then what will remain is the 1. Okay, so your u max, the maximum velocity, is going to be minus h square by 8 mu dou p by dou x. Okay, now once we have the maximum velocity, now let us find out the discharge. Okay, and from discharge we can find out the average velocity, right? So if we do that, we can write down u average is equals to discharge divided by the distance between the plates per unit width, right? So here we are actually calculating flow rate per flow area, but flow area is h multiplied by 1. That 1 is nothing but your unit width, or 1 unit width. Okay, so h multiplied by 1 is implicit here, so q by h. And now this q we can write down as integration from minus h by 2 to h by 2, that's from the bottom plate to the top plate, okay, u dy. So at every elemental strip we try to find out what is the discharge and integrate from minus h by 2 to plus h by 2 to get the total discharge. So u dy integrated over minus h by 2 to plus h by 2. So this is your q, and because we have 1 by h here, that 1 by h has also come here. Okay. Now here in this expression, let us substitute the expression for this velocity u. If we do that, we can write down u average is equals to 1 by 2 integration minus h by 2 to plus h by 2 u dy, and u is here minus h square by 8 mu dou p by dou x multiplied by 1 minus 4 y by h square, right? So once we have this, we already know that this term is nothing but your u max, which is going to be a constant value, and you can take it out. So we have rephrased it with this, that is u max by h and integration minus h by 2 to h by 2 1 minus 4 y by h square dy. This is more simplified, and if we integrate this and substitute the limits, then we could write down that u average is equals to 2 by 3 u max. So you integrate and find out this expression and substitute the value of y by h, and then finally you could get U average is equals to 2 by 3 U max. So the average velocity is going to be 2 by 3 U max, or in other words, you can write down U max is equals to 1.5 times U average. Okay. So either you know U max, you can calculate U average, or if you know U average, you can calculate the maximum velocity within the plates. Okay. Once we have these values, next we can always find out what is the shear stress at the boundary. So to get it, the shear stress at the wall or at the boundary for the parallel flow in the channel, you have tau xy or tau yx depending on the direction. That is basically at y equals to either plus h by 2 or minus h by 2. So we have our basic equation, tau is equals to mu dou u by dou y, right? So here there is a minus symbol because our direction of x is in the positive x direction, that is the direction of flow, but the shear stress is going to act in the opposite direction, the shear stress on the wall. See, please understand, we are talking about shear stress, it is acting at the wall. Either you are talking the stress acting on the fluid or stress acting on the plate. Okay, so the shear stress, the resistance, is always in the opposing direction of the flow, so it is in the negative x direction. That's why we have a sign that's minus. So you have written minus mu dou u by dou y. Okay, and once we have this, what we need to do, we need to find out the value for dou u by dou y. We already know what is u. If you take dou u by dou y, you can write down that is equals to minus h square by 8 mu dou p by dou x multiplied by minus 4 2y by h square. And if you see, this is nothing but your u max. And if you just simplify this, you will get minus 8y by h square. Okay. So now we will take this and substitute in the expression and get it, that is equals to minus mu u max multiplied by minus 8h by h square, okay, multiplied by 2. So whole thing is going to give rise to this expression, which is nothing but 4 mu u max by h. Okay, so the shear stress at the wall is nothing but 4 mu u max by h. Okay, and once we have this shear stress, from this we can find out what is the coefficient of friction, okay, or friction coefficient, whatever you want to find out. So the coefficient of friction we know is given as tau equals to cf multiplied by half rho u square. So the shear stress is equals to the coefficient of friction multiplied by half rho u square, or in other words, coefficient of friction is equals to tau, that's the shear stress, divided by this term. Now we already have derived what is the value of tau at the wall. That is nothing but 4 mu u max by h divided by half rho u square, or u average square, is going to give you the value of coefficient of friction. Okay, by simplifying this, we could write down this term as 12 mu divided by rho h u average. So this rho h u average divided by mu is nothing but your Reynolds number, Re. Okay, so rho, this is the characteristic dimension, h, or the distance between the plates. U average is the average velocity within the plates, divided by mu is the viscosity, dynamic viscosity, is nothing but your Reynolds number. So finally we could write down CF is the coefficient of friction is equals to 12 divided by Re, 12 divided by the Reynolds number. Okay, and this equation is valid for laminar flows. See, please remember, we are discussing the flow between the parallel plates, and we have not considered the turbulence and various other characteristics. So this condition or this equation what we have derived is valid for laminar flow, and it is written that RE up to 2300, which is usually considered as laminar flow in pipes. So that same thing will be valid in this case. Alright. Okay. Now, having understood this plane Poiseuille flow, that is the flow between two parallel plates. Now let us look at the flow through a pipe. Okay. So that is called Hagen-Poiseuille flow. So basically flow through a circular tube or pipe. So let us again consider the same way the velocities as well as the flow parameters in this circular tube. So in circular tube, the dimensions are, one is along the length of the tube, that we consider, let us say Z, and you have the radial dimension, that is R, and you have the angular dimension, that is theta. So the coordinate system for this circular tube, we consider it as R, theta and Z. So R is the radial direction, theta is the angular direction, and Z is along the length of the tube. So we have three different dimensions which are going to constitute your coordinate system. For this coordinate system, we assume that the flow is taking place within the pipe and the flow is fully developed. Okay, which we will discuss slightly later, what is the fully developed flow and what is happening. But fully developed flow means the flow is no more going to change within the pipe given the discharge, everything remains same. Okay, so as we see that when the flow enters, there might be some changes, but after some time, after some distance, the flow is not really going to change. The flow will remain same. We need to achieve that fully developed flow condition and then analyze. So what we are analyzing here is a fully developed flow. So the assumption is, or the consideration is, you have a fully developed laminar flow through straight tube of circular cross section. Okay, that's what we are analyzing. Now in this case, what are the velocities which are going to exist? The velocity in the Z direction is going to exist, right? What about the velocity in the radial direction? It is going to be zero. All right. So there is also going to be rotational symmetry. In any direction, there is going to be a symmetry, or the flow is symmetric. So if we take the velocity, that is Vz as well as V theta, these are zero. In addition, the derivative Vz by V theta is also, dou Vz by dou theta is also going to be zero. So basically that satisfies the rotational symmetry. If you have rotational symmetry, the gradient in the theta direction is going to be zero. So even though Vz exists, okay, dou Vz by dou theta is going to be zero, or any term, the gradient of any term in the theta direction is going to be zero. Now let us write down all the terms. So let us take Z axis as the axis of the tube along which the fluid particle travel, that is Vz is not equals to zero, and Vr as well as V theta are zero, and at the same time dou Vz by dou theta is also zero. Okay, so once we have understood this, let us look at the governing equations. What are the governing equations? These are Navier-Stokes equation and continuity equation, isn't it? So if we look at the continuity equation and Navier-Stokes equation in the R, theta and Z coordinate system, it looks little bit complex. Okay, so because this is cylindrical coordinates, we have to convert it into that coordinate system. So I'm not going to derive that. If somebody is really interested, you can always go and find out the derivation, how it is written. but let us not worry about it. Let us straight away take the equations and start simplifying. Our crux of this discussion and understanding is to simplify the Navier-Stokes equation for the exact problems and how we can use that simplified governing equation to solve it and get a solution. So if you look at continuity equation, this is what is our equation, which is dou ur divided by dou r plus ur by r plus 1 by r dou u theta by dou theta plus dou uz by dou z is equals to 0. This is for incompressible flows, okay? And similarly, if we write down the r component of this Navier-Stokes equation in cylindrical coordinate system, then you will get this expression, which looks much longer, okay? But let us not worry. This is our equation in the r component. This is the equation in the theta component. This is the equation in the z component. All right. Now here, what we need to do is to understand what are the velocity components. We have ur, okay, u theta, and uz. We have already seen earlier that ur and u theta are going to be 0, and any derivative with respect to theta is going to be also 0. So if we start neglecting all those terms, we can derive and write down the equation that finally we could get from this set of complex equations. Okay, so without spending time on this, let me go to that next simplification. You already know how to delete different terms. So now from the continuity equation that we had, we can write down 1 by r dou by dou r r v r plus 1 by r dou by dou theta v theta plus dou by dou z v z. So just to quickly correlate that, you see here you have dou u r by dou r plus u r by r. So that we have written as 1 by r dou by dou r r v r. Okay. So I think there is a small change you should note down. Here we are, I have written u r, u theta, and u z, but further in these slides I have used vr, v theta, and vz, so they both are same, don't get confused. Okay, so now for rotational symmetry, we know it's going to be 1 by r dou v theta by dou theta is going to be 0. Okay, so this term is going to be 0. Once we say that this term is going to be 0, we can clearly say that the vz is not going to be a function of theta, it is going to be a function of r and t. So now invoking vr is equals to 0, which is known to us, v theta is equals to 0, and dou by dou theta of any quantity is equals to 0 based on the condition of symmetry, rotational symmetry. In the Navier-Stokes equation, if you substitute all these parameters, you can write down dou vz by dou t is equals to minus 1 by rho dou p by dou z plus nu dou square vz by dou r square plus 1 by r dou vz by dou r. That's in the z direction. Okay. So we had these three equations, and if you substitute, you will actually come to this equation which will return, and in this equation you will have these terms which will remain after you substitute all these conditions which I have already discussed. Okay, now if you take a steady flow, what will happen? The dou vz by dou t is going to disappear, right? So next, if we say once you have dou vz by dou t is equal to 0 for a steady flow, what do you have? You have only these terms. Okay, so you will have dou vz dou square vz by dou r square plus 1 by r dou vz by dou r. All right, that is going to be equals to minus 1 by rho dou p by dou z. Now let us write down that equation. This is slightly changed, the rho has been taken out, and you have this equation which is nothing but a steady flow, nothing but for the steady flow condition. Okay, now once we have this equation, let us look at the boundary conditions. Okay, This is a cylindrical coordinate system flow, and the flow is taking place through a tube, circular tube. Now, what are the boundary conditions? You have the center line at the center of the pipe. Z is in this direction of flow. R is radially outwards. Okay. Theta is angular direction. Now, at R is equal to 0, that is at the center line, Vz is going to be finite. It does exist. But at R is equal to capital R, that is radius of the circular tube, what is going to be the Vz? It's going to be 0. We know that the wall, if it is the wall is rigid or static, then the velocity is also going to be the same, that is Vz is equal to 0. So from this, we can write down this equation, right? And let us now integrate. We need to find out Vz, right? So we have to integrate and get the value of Vz. So if we do that, this equation we can write down like this, just rephrasing this equation, dou by dou r Vz by dou Vz by dou r, okay? That is equals to 1 by mu dou p by dou z multiplied by r. And now if we integrate this with respect to r, then we will be able to get r dou Vz by dou r equals to 1 by 2 mu dou p by dou z r square plus a. Now again, if you rephrase this again, take this r to the right hand side, you will be able to write down this equation. Okay. Now, once we have dou Vz by dou r, we integrate it with respect to r, then we will be able to write down Vz is equals to 1 by 4 mu dou p by dou z r square plus a ln r plus b. Okay. So this is just integration after rephrasing and putting the terms in a systematic manner. Okay. Now, once we have this, let us look at the boundary conditions. What are the boundary conditions? You have already at r equals to 0, your Vz is finite, and r equals to r, capital R, your Vz is equals to 0. So when we are telling r equals to 0, that's at the center line, Vz is finite, for this, we have to have a equals to 0, then only it will be satisfied. Okay, once we are telling Vz is going to exist at r equals to 0, that means your a has to be 0. Okay, so that is obtained. Now let us go to the next boundary condition, that's your r equals to r, capital R, your Vz equals to 0. So now you substitute this. If you substitute this, what will happen? This is capital R, this is 0. So your b is equals to minus 1 by 4 mu dou p by dou z capital R square. Okay, so we got a equals to 0 and b equals to this. By substituting these two constants a and b, you can write down the expression for Vz, that is nothing but R square by 4 mu minus dou p by dou z multiplied by 1 minus small r square by capital R square. Okay, so this shows that the axial velocity profile in a fully developed laminar pipe, laminar flow through pipe, okay, is going to have a parabolic profile. This equation is again a parabolic equation. So your profile is going to be parabolic with variation along R. Okay. So once we have obtained this, let us look at the maximum velocity. We know at R equals to 0, Vz is going to be maximum. Okay. So if we substitute that r equals to 0, if you substitute 0 here, what will be your maximum velocity? Your Vz is going to be r square by 4 mu minus dou p by dou z. So the maximum velocity is obtained. Now let us look at the average velocity. Average velocity, what we do? We find out the discharge, that is Q, by integrating the flow across the area and then divide by the area. So let us do that. So the average velocity in the channel, you can write down V average equals to Q by area, that is pi R square in this case, right? Q is equals to, integration 0 to r 2 pi r vz dr. So we are taking elemental strip. So in the elemental strip, let us say that is the velocity is vz at that distance r, and we are multiplying with the distance we are taking in radial direction, that is dr. Okay, and you take 2 pi r. All right, so just to explain you quickly, let me try to draw this. So this is your pipe. I think there is some problem here, doesn't matter. So from here, if I take any radial distance r, okay, and at this radius, if I consider a strip, okay, I don't know why this is happening anyway. So this strip and this distance is dr. All right, so the flow through this is nothing but your vz, that you have the velocity at this location, multiplied by dr, and that is only, let us say, for small strip here. But if you want to get the full circular strip, then you multiply with 2 pi r, okay, and then you integrate that from r equals to 0 to capital R. You will get the complete discharge that is going to flow through the pipe. So that's what we have done here. Integrating from 0 to r, 2 pi r vz r dr, divided by the area, that is pi r square. So by simplifying that, you could write down this expression, and further, if you simplify that, you will be able to write down vz average is equals to r square divided by 8 mu minus dou p by dou z. Okay, now look at the expression that we have derived for V max, that is here, right? So if you look at these two expressions, you can easily write down it is equals to vz average equals to 1 by 2 vz max, or in other words, you can write down vz max is equals to 2 times the vz average, or the maximum velocity within this tubular pipe is equals to 2 times the average velocity of that. In plain Poiseuille flow, we had derived vz max is equals to 1.5 times the average velocity, but in Hagen Poiseuille flow, we derived that vz max is equals to 2 times the average velocity. Okay, so once we have the average velocity and maximum velocities, let us look at the discharge and how we can establish some relations which will be possibly useful. Now, the discharge, that is Q, through the pipe is going to be area multiplied by the average velocity. We have derived from there only. So if we write down pi r square is the area multiplied by the V average, or Vz average is the velocity, that's going to give you Q. And if you substitute the value of Vz average, you can write down pi r square multiplied by r square by 8 mu multiplied by minus dou p by dou z. So finally, this expression gives rise to minus pi d4. We have converted the r to d, or radius to diameter. So pi d4 by 128 mu dou p by dou z. So this is one expression, that is Q is equals to minus pi d4 by 128 mu dou p by dou z, is very useful in number of applications. Okay, this equation is commonly used in the measurement of viscosity with the help of capillary tube viscometers. What is that basically, capillary tube viscometers? So you have a thin pipe, okay, thin circular straight pipe, through which you basically allow the flow to take place. So you have some liquid and you want to find out the viscosity of this liquid. So what you do, you put it in a tank and connect a very small diameter tubular pipe to that, and in that pipe you allow the flow to take place. Okay, when you are allowing the flow to take place, what do you measure? You measure the pressures at these specified two locations. Let us say at point 1 and 2, you get pressure P1 and P2. And what do you do with that? You just see the equation next. we can write down mu is equal to minus pi d4 divided by 128 q dou p by dou z or dou l. In this case is the length, so dou l. Okay, so in this we know what is the diameter of the pipe that is installed by us, so we know what is the diameter. We know the length between these two points, that is L. We know the pressure at these two points, from which we can find out dou P by dou L, right? So P2 minus P1 divided by L is going to give you the dou P by dou L term, and we know the diameter D. Once we allow the flow to pass through for certain amount of time and we collect at this end, we can measure the discharge. So the volume that is collected over a period of time can be used to find out the discharge. Once you have discharge, you have the value of Q. So you substitute the discharge here, Q, diameter D, and P2 minus P1 divided by L is going to give you the value of the viscosity that you will get. So in experimental facilities, you can use this setup to find out the viscosity of a given liquid and get your answer for that viscosity. Okay, so this is a typical application that is also used. Now let us look at the other things. What we could find out from this next, we could also find out the shear stress. So how do you find out the shear stress that we have already seen? We have to write down the expression, that is tau is equals to mu dou vz by dou r. Okay, what we are going to find out is dou vz by dou r and substitute here. So what is vz? Vz is this, that is r square divided by 4 mu minus dou p by dou z multiplied by 1 minus small r square by capital R square. Now if you substitute in this expression and find out the value of dou vz by dou r, you can write down that is as r square divided by 4 mu multiplied by minus dou p by dou z multiplied by minus 2r by r square. So minus minus gets added and plus, it is positive. Then you have r square cancels out. Finally, the expression that you get is 1 by 2 mu dou p by dou z multiplied by r. So the mu, that is the shear stress, is basically tau, that is the shear stress, is equals to mu multiplied by this term that we have got. Okay, so by doing that, we could write down tau r is equals to 1 by 2 dou p by dou z r. So as the radius increases, your shear stress changes. And once we want to find out, let us say, the shear stress at the wall, we will substitute the value of r equals to capital R. Okay, so this indicates that tau varies linearly in the radial direction from the axis. Okay, at axis the shear stress is going to be zero and shear stress is going to be maximum at the wall. So we can find out the shear stress at the wall, that is r equals to r tau max, or the maximum shear stress, is equals to 1 by 2 dou p by dou z capital R. All right, so if we find out the shear stress at the wall, we can also find out the force now on the pipe. Let us say there is a flow taking place and you can calculate what is the shear stress on the pipe. You can also calculate what is the force that is going to be exerted on the pipe. Now if I have a pipe and I have to have a flow through that, I need to fix the pipe. So I need to understand how much force is going to act on the pipe and how strong my fixture should be to take that force. Because if you don't hold it properly, it might get displaced. You don't want that. So the fixture strength and the load carrying capacity can be calculated from this, isn't it? So again, over a pipe of length L, if the length is L, then the total shear force is going to be calculated. That is nothing but Fs is the shear force, tau max multiplied by 2 pi r is the circumference multiplied by L. So that's the area. So shear stress multiplied by area over which it is going to act is going to give you the force. All right, so once we know the tau max, we substitute this in the equation and we can write down that is equals to 1 by 2 P2 minus P1 divided by L pi R square L. So if you simplify this, you will see it is nothing but minus pi R square multiplied by P1 minus P2. So if you know the pressure at two locations in the pipe, P1 and P2, then you just multiply by the area, that is going to give you the force. Okay, so it's very simple. All right, so if we write it down, Fs is the force on the shear force on the surface of this pipe is going to be equals to the area multiplied by the pressure drop between the specified length. Okay, so the reason we have a negative sign here because you are taking P1 minus P2. Okay, your gradient is going to be negative. So eventually you will get the force as positive. Okay, or if you don't take the other way around, you will get a negative value, which basically says that the force is in the opposite direction what you assumed. All right. So the negative sign indicated that the force is acting in opposite to the flow direction. All right. Now let us find out the other characters or other parameters, which is friction factors and losses. So we know the losses or head loss due to friction is HF, and that is nothing but your pressure drop over the length divided by unit weight of the liquid. So pressure drop divided by rho g. What is pressure drop? Your pressure drop is nothing but dou p by dou z, or pressure drop is dou p. So to get that value of pressure drop, we can use this expression and simplify to find out the pressure drop dou p. Okay, so rewriting this, we can have minus dou p by dou z is equals to 8 mu vz average divided by r square. Okay, and that is equals to, finally we can put it as 32 mu vz average divided by d square. So basically d square by 4, right? So if you put it, you will get this expression. And over a finite length L, once we know this is the pressure drop, we are applying over a finite length L. Okay, the head loss is going to be HF equals to 32 mu VZ average divided by D square multiplied by L 1 by rho g. So we had pressure drop divided by rho g. So this is the expression for head loss. Okay, so the head loss in a pipe is derived like this, but we already know in Darcy-Weisbach expression, which you might have also conducted in the labs, in the Darcy-Weisbach equation, we have the formula, or Darcy-Weisbach formula, that is HF is equals to FL V square, V is nothing but your V average, divided by 2GD is the diameter, right? So here we have this expression FL V square by 2GD, and we have this F, which is nothing but your coefficient of friction or friction factor. Okay, so you can use coefficient of friction or friction factor, but in this case it is friction factor. So now if we say RE, RE is nothing but rho V D by mu. Okay, so if you substitute that and equate these two expressions, we can write down F is equals to 64 by RE. So you equate these two expressions, HF equals to this and HF equals to this, and then you will get the expression in which you may use RE in place of rho V D by mu. So finally you could write down F equals to 64 by RE. In case of plain Poiseuille flow, we had seen that F is equals to 12 by RE. And in this case, in case of Hagen Poiseuille flow, we could derive that F is equals to 64 by RE. So for a flow through pipe, your F is equals to 64 by RE, and this friction factor, whatever we have derived, is applicable for laminar flow through pipe. Or in details, if you want to write down, it is basically applicable for fully developed laminar flow through the pipe. Okay, so this is nothing but your Darcy or Moody's friction factor. You have used the Darcy's friction factor or Moody's diagram. So the friction factor that we are using is derived using such principles. Okay, all right. Now let us try to calculate that. The Darcy's friction factor or CF, you can write down as tau is the shear stress at the wall divided by half rho Vz average. So this is a typo. This is Vz average square. So now if we substitute tau z, that's equals to 4 mu Vz average divided by R divided by 1 by 2 rho Vz average square. That will give you the answer as 16 by Re. Okay. So you have here coefficient of friction, that is 16 by Re, and earlier we could find out the friction factor, that is 64 by Re. So from here we could clearly see that there is a relation between the friction factor and coefficient of friction. So friction factor is 4 times the coefficient of friction. Okay. So in many cases, many books and so on, you may find that 4 CF multiplied by so and so. In some other books, you will find out F multiplied by so and so. So not to get confused about it, you should know that the friction factor that we derived for Darcy's flow is friction factor is F is 4 times the coefficient of friction. Okay. And using this, the Moody's diagram has been constructed for the laminar flow. If you see, this line shows the laminar flow, that is F equals to Re. But if you come to all other lines, these are not for laminar flow, these are for turbulent flows. And based on the experimental studies, all these lines have been drawn. And if you look at this plot, in the x-axis you have Reynolds number, and in y-axis on right side you have relative roughness coefficient, or relative roughness, that is roughness height divided by the diameter or characteristic dimension. And the y-axis on the left hand side you have friction factor. Okay, so using this diagram we can solve many of the problems. We can, if we know the flow conditions and the relative roughness and so on, we can find out what is the friction factor or vice versa. Okay, so with this, let us now solve one example. So let us take this example for plain Poiseuille flow conditions. It says a viscous oil flows steadily between two stationary parallel plates. The flow is laminar and fully developed. The gap height is 20 mm. So you have two parallel plates. Flow is laminar and fully developed. The distance between the plates, or the gap between the plates, is 20 mm. The oil that flows has a viscosity of 0.1 Newton second per meter square. The specific gravity of that oil is 0.8. And the pressure gradient is minus 1000 Newton meter square per meter length. Okay. Find the magnitude and direction of the shear stress on the upper plate. If the unit discharge Q is given as 0.15 meter cube per meter per second. Okay. Because we are calculating per meter length. So this is given. We have the parallel plates and we are talking about per meter width. So that's why per meter is coming in all the locations. Now let us look at the solution. So how do you solve it? Okay. First, you find out what are the parameters that are given. What are given? Your Q is equals to 0.15 meter cube per second per meter width. Dou P by dou X is given, that is minus 1000 Newton per meter cube. Mu is given. S, that is the specific gravity, is given. And H is the distance between the plates, that is also given. So we need to find out the shear stress, isn't it? So shear stress, if you write down the expression, it is 4 mu U max by H at the wall, that is y equals to h by 2 or minus h by 2, whatever you want to take. So now let us find out u max. What is u max? In this we need to obtain u max. U max is nothing but minus h square by 8 mu dou p by dou x. And we know the values. We know dou p by dou x. We know h. We know mu. So if you substitute the values here, then you will be able to write down this expression. Okay. H square divided by 8 mu multiplied by the dou p by dou x 1000. Okay. So once we have this, this gives us the value as 0.5 meter per second. Okay. Now substitute this value of u max in the expression for tau. Okay. So that is going to give you tau is equals to 4, mu is 0.1, and u max is equals to 0.5 that we have already obtained, divided by your h, that is 20 mm, 20 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 3. That is going to give you the shear stress equals to 10 newton per meter square. And what is the direction? Direction is going to be in the direction of flow. It acts in the direction of flow. Okay. So it is very simple. Once you know what are the parameters that are given, then you just find out what is the expression and start substituting, you will get the answer. But for that, you need to understand or you need to remember what is this expression. If you don't remember, it doesn't take much time. You quickly derive that. You will be able to get it. Isn't it? Okay. So with this, let us stop in this lecture. And we have discussed the exact solutions. In the previous lecture, we have already discussed the flow through parallel plates where one plate was moving. It is a curved flow. In this lecture, we have discussed plane Poiseuille flow and Hagen-Poiseuille flow. So with this, we have completed the exact solutions part. In the next lecture, we will take the approximate solution of Navier-Stokes equation. Okay. Okay. With this, let me thank you and wish you a good day. Take care.